give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. You give life. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Can a nation be changed? Can a nation be saved? Can a nation be turned back to you? Can a nation be changed? Can a nation be saved? Can a nation be turned back to you? We're on our knees. We're on our knees again. We're on our knees. We're on our knees again.
And this nation be changed. Let this nation be saved. Let this nation be turned back to you,
to you, to you, Jesus.
Let this nation be changed.
Oh Lord,
let this nation be saved. Let this nation be turned back to you. We're on our knees. We're on our knees again. We're on our knees. We're on our knees again. We're on our knees. We're on our knees again. Oh Lord, we're on our knees. We're on our knees again.
Lifted up you ancient doors, let the King of Glory in. Be lifted up you ancient doors, let the King of Glory in. Lifted up you ancient doors, let the King of Glory in again. Let him in again, come in again, Lord, come in again, Lord. Be lifted up you ancient doors, let the King of Glory in. Be lifted up you ancient doors, let the King of Glory in again. Let him in again, let you in again, come in again, Lord. Change the nation, God, or change the face of the earth. We're on our knees again. We're on our knees. We're on our knees again and again and again.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're to my heart, yeah. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, 'cause it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, 'cause it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. All about you.
Jesus, we bring you more than a song. We bring our heart, Lord Jesus, that we will have hearts of worship, to worship in spirit and truth. Come, Holy Spirit, now upon us. Fill us to overflowing. Protect us and guard us and speak to our hearts at this time. Lord, come in power. Come in power. And Lord, we step before you, towards you now. And we ask, Lord Jesus, that you just give us your forgiveness, your life, and your love. Let's just spend a moment and think of those things you would like to give to Jesus this week. Those things you've said and done and thought that you wish you hadn't. And just hand them to him. Those attitudes, those things you haven't trusted God with, just hand them over to him. How God gives us a fresh start every moment of the day when we call on him. Kona mayanta. Thank you, Jesus. Kona mayanta, God bless. Kona mayanta, God. Lord, we thank you and praise that your spirit is here. We receive your forgiveness. We receive your love. We receive, Lord Jesus, all that you want to give us today. Lord, be here in the church, be in the living room. Be whatever room that you're sitting in now, that the Lord will meet with you. Whatever place you're in, that the Lord will meet you. Come in power, we pray, Lord Jesus. That we may worship you in spirit and truth. Amen. Amen. Please be seated, those that are here. First of all, just to say, because of the COVID regulations, everything that's going on, we as a church had to make decisions. We are allowed to be open, but we decided that we needed to be extra, extra safe. And particularly for those that can't do Zoom and or struggle with Zoom, we want them to be able to feel safe coming in here. So actually, the worship band was the biggest risk because we were up here. The worship band, for the next 3 weeks, we won't have worship band. And the tech is all being done by Paul and David at the moment. And Paul's doing a great job here. So me, Jenny, and Paul are kind of doing the bits around. And then it makes it safe for those people that need to come in and because they can't do Zoom or other things, or if they're part of the service. So it makes it much safer. So we are doing our deep cleaning. And it's just the few people who need to be here that are coming, and praise God for them. It's so good to see you this morning, and very welcome. And also, welcome to those on the phone, Evelyn, Joan, Heather, and Marie. I can't wait to see all your faces again soon. I really can't. And welcome to those on Zoom, and welcome to those on YouTube that will watch this later. You, and may the presence of God really fill you. And may the presence of God really touch you wherever you are today. We need the presence of God across this nation and across this world, don't we? With all that's going on, we so need the presence of God. And we need the presence of God in our life. And I don't know about you, but I'm finding this lockdown the hardest because it's gone on and on and on. But actually, in the waiting, let us wait on Jesus. Let us wait on Jesus. Let us wait on his timing. He has a timing. And I'm going to talk about later a bit about the prayer tomorrow. We must be on our knees. I chose that song particularly. I actually chose a song, which I don't normally, but I chose Can a Nation Be Changed? Because I believe the nation can be changed. In fact, I believe the world could be changed if we're on our knees, if we're praying, if we humble ourselves and get before God. And we're going to be fasting and praying tomorrow, those that can fast, even if it's just one meal. We're going to seek God. And we're going to ask for an end to COVID, and we're going to believe for the impossible. So amen. Amen, amen. Bless you all. So we're going to go to Barbara now, who's going to bring our reading, which is 1 Kings 18, 16 to 39. Thank you, Barbara. Good to see you.
Thank you. Morning, everyone. 1 Kings 18, starting at verse 16. So Obadiah went to meet Ahab and told him, and Ahab went to meet Elijah. When he saw Elijah, he said to him, "Is that you, you troubler of Israel?" "I have not made trouble for Israel," Elijah replied, "but you and your father's family have. You have abandoned the Lord's commands and you have followed the Baals. Now summon the people from all over Israel to meet me on Mount Carmel, and bring the 450 prophets of Baal and the 400 prophets of Asherah who eat at Jezebel's table." So Ahab sent word throughout all Israel and assembled the prophets on Mount Carmel. Elijah went before the people and said, "How long will you waver between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal is God, follow him." But the people said nothing. Then Elijah said to them, "I am the only one of the Lord's prophets left, but Baal has 450 prophets. Get two bulls for us. Let them choose one for themselves, and let them cut it into pieces and put it on the wood, but not set fire to it. I will prepare the other bull and put it on the wood, but not set fire to it. Then you call on the name of your God, and I will call on the name of the Lord. The God who answers by fire, he is God. Then all the people said, what you say is good. Elijah said to the prophets of Baal, choose one of the bulls and prepare it first. Since there are so many of you, call on the name of your God, but do not light the fire. So they took the bull given them and then prepared it. Then they called on the name of Baal from morning till noon. O Baal, answer us, they shouted. But there was no response. No one answered. And they danced around the altar that they had made. At noon, Elijah began to taunt them. Shout louder, he said. Surely he is a god. Perhaps he is deep in thought, or busy, or travelling. Maybe he's sleeping and must be awakened. So they shouted louder and slashed themselves with swords and spears, as was their custom, until their blood flowed. Midday passed, and they continued their frantic prophesying until the time for the evening sacrifice. But there was no response. No one answered. No one paid attention. Then Elijah said to all the people, come here to me. They came to him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord, which was in ruins. Elijah took 12 stones, one for each of the tribes descended from Jacob, to whom the word of the Lord had come, saying, your name shall be Israel. With the stones, he built an altar in the name of the Lord, and he dug a trench around it, large enough for 2 seahs of seed. He arranged the wood, cut the bull into pieces, and laid it on the wood. Then he said to them, fill 4 large jars with water and pour it on the offering and on the wood. Do it again, he said, and they did it again. Do it a third time, he ordered, and they did it the third time. The water ran down around the altar and even filled the trench. At the time of the sacrifice, the prophet Elijah stepped forward and prayed, O Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known today that you are God in Israel and that I am your servant and have done all these things at your command. Answer me, O Lord. Answer me so that these people will know that you, O Lord, are God and that you are turning their hearts back again. Then the fire of the Lord fell and burned up the sacrifice, the wood, the stones and the soil, and also licked up the water in the trench. When all the people saw this, they fell prostrate and cried, the Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Barbara. Bless you. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, speak to us today that your word will transform us, change us, and mold us. Amen. So I mentioned tomorrow, I've got a little box here. Is that all right? Paul, I'm just checking. Okay, I can go on. So I mentioned that tomorrow we're going to join together to pray for an end to COVID. It's been really exciting, the amount of churches and other Christians that are joining in this as well. So can I just encourage you, as St. James Church, as whatever church you're from, whoever you are, engage with it. Please engage with it. We've sent some prayers through for the day in the morning, afternoon and evening, just to direct the day. I've sent them all over the place, actually, and people are using them. So use them, please, and engage. And we're encouraging people, if you're able to fast, if you're not able to fast, if you have a medical condition, please don't. But if you are able to fast, even if it's one meal, and pray during that time, or give up telly during that time, whatever you choose to do, please do that. Because we need to get serious about COVID. And we need to get serious about praying, don't we, to our God. So even if you're at work, you can join in, because you will, those prayers, I'm going to put them on the WhatsApps as well, by the way, during the day, so you'll get them. You already got them, hopefully. So just join in. Join in, I ask you. Let us pray seriously. Let us get on our knees. Let's pray. If you can't get on your knees, it doesn't matter. It's a heart thing. Pray. Seek God. Our God is the only God, and in Jesus we have victory and we have power when we pray. We'll be live on Facebook at 8:30 a.m. Uzza will be with us then. At 1 p.m. Alice is going to be with me and Paul as well. And at 8:30 in the evening, we are going to be live. We're going to be live on Facebook on all those, and they'll all be put on YouTube just about an hour or so later in each one. And 8:30 in the evening, you can actually join the Zoom, which has already been sent out. That will be put live on Facebook for the prayers that we do initially, and then you'll be put in groups to pray with each other. So you can join in, and it will only be about half an hour we'll do them, probably. About 15 minutes praying and then 15 minutes in your groups. But let's pray. Let's make a difference by just getting up, just seeking God at this time. And it's so exciting to see so many people wanting to do that. I had to have even written to the Queen asking for a National Day of Prayer, so pray about that. I've written to Prime Minister and I keep writing to people. Anyway, all write in and ask. Anyway, today we're starting a new preaching series. We're looking at the Ten Commandments over the next few weeks. The Ten Commandments can be found in Exodus 20, 2-17, and Deuteronomy 5, 6-21. So I'd encourage you to look at them, okay? So Exodus 20, 2-17, and Deuteronomy 5, 6-21. I will put them up another week. I haven't got them this week, but I will put them up, probably list them so you can just see them. But the next 2 weeks, I'm doing There Are No Other Gods. In other words, we love the God with all our heart. It crosses a little bit into idols as well. But next week, Rosemary's looking at idols. And these are two really, really important commandments. That's why they're really important that we get a grip of making sure that God is first. God is first. So we're looking at the first commandment today. And that is that you shall have no other gods before me. You shall have no other gods before me. And the reading, of course, was about Elijah. And it's a reminder, isn't it, of how powerful God is. Isn't God a powerful God that we serve? The Bible has these wonderful stories about this amazing God that we serve and that does so much for us. And it's just miracles everywhere, isn't it? Can we believe for miracles, please? Can we believe for them? Be expectant of God. Our God is the one that can do the impossible. So I want to challenge you, who is your God and how big is he? And do you have other gods before Yahweh? Do you love other things better than you love God? Do you? The God of the Old Testament, you see, is the God of the New Testament. If we separate them, we will not understand the full person of God. It's really important that we get to grips with that. So often churches are a bit outweighed. They either concentrate on the Father or the Spirit or Jesus, but actually we need all three. The full person of God is the Trinity, who is revealed through the Son Jesus as he shows us who the Father is and releases the power of the Spirit into our lives. We need all that. We need the power of the Spirit. We need the love of the Father, and we need the sacrifice of the Son to bring us into relationship with the true one God. Let's not get out of balance here. All are God. This is the God we are to put first. The God who loves us like the perfect father loves a child. The God who came to save us and knows us like Jesus knows us and shows us the Father. And the God who empowers us with his Spirit. This is the living and true God. The God of Elijah is the God of today as well. He's the God of today. Elijah, whose name actually means God is Yahweh. What a great name to have, eh? I've talked about names in the past, how important they are, and you know, and how important it was to me when I realized my name means victory. What does your name mean? What does it say about you? But God is Yahweh. Good name. We need more Elijahs around, don't we? He was a prophet who lived in the northern kingdom of Israel. Some of the miracles around him even included raising someone from the dead. And he led the school of prophets, called the Sons of the Prophets at the time. There were these wonderful schools of prophets. I have such a heart for the prophetic. And we need to hear God's word today. What is God saying to a nation? What is God saying to us? Let's be the prophets. And Elijah trusted God. And he knew his God. He knew him. We see that through his life. We see that how he engages with God over this time. In the scripture, Elijah the great prophet proves that the God who he serves is the living God, the one true God. Unlike Baal, Baal is dead. He's not alive. Ahab here had turned from the living God and started worshipping idols. Baal, and that actually means that he worshipped several idols, were part of the whole Baal worship. And it is Elijah, actually, who then challenges Baal to a match with the living God. He knows his God. He loves his God. He knows him. They go to Mount Carmel, which is actually a range of hills, okay? And a traditional site, actually, to worship Baal. Get that? So Elijah is so confident of his God, he even fights them on their ground. He knows that his God is greater. He knows that that earth belongs to his God, not Baal. He knows that the one true God can take Baal. Sounds like a boxing match, doesn't it? But the point was, at this point, Ahab and the people were worshipping both Baal and Yahweh, and it is now that they have to decide who to worship for real. They're hedging their bets at the moment, and Elijah is challenging their attitude. You cannot have your foot in two camps, you know. Either you choose the living God, Yahweh, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, shown through Jesus, or you don't. You're either in or out. Either following Jesus and choosing him, or you don't. But if you've given your life to Jesus, you say, Lord, come in. He's there. He shows up. How God shows up when we call on him. Baal actually was the God responsible for harvest. And here we are reminded there is, again, only one true God who is in charge of nature. He's in charge of everything. Here, Ahab and his people are being challenged. Which God do you serve? Which God do you love? Which God has your heart? They have to choose. Choice is the greatest gift God ever gave us, because it makes things worth something. When you choose something, it has value. Elijah makes it difficult for himself, actually. He makes it difficult for God, or you think he does. He doesn't really. He does everything, actually, to make sure the circumstances seem impossible, to prove that the living God is in fact living, that Yahweh is real and powerful and deserving of worship. They're in a drought even at this point, so water is incredibly precious. So using water in that way was just another way of proving how much he trusted his God, loved his God, and had faith in his God. And through the prayer of Elijah, both fire and water come from heaven. However, of course, the people still do not honor God. They still do not bow their knee to him. They still not worshiping him. And they don't honor Elijah either. God has done something amazing. I wonder how many of us have had amazing things happen in our life, and yet we so easy forget, don't we? So easy to forget. But they get amazing, but the people, get angry. They reject the living God in these circumstances, and they reject Elijah, God's prophet. And you know what? There will be times when we stand for God. We stand for Jesus. We stand for the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And world, the nation, people will reject us. But our God is greater. We have to keep on trusting. Because the point is, Jesus won the battle. We might still be fighting the war, but he's won the battle. And we're his people. So we're on the winning side. You're on the winning side. I'm on the winning side. God is in charge. We have eternity. And Elijah has his weaknesses as well. That's what I love about Elijah, because I don't know about you, but I know I have my weaknesses. He quivers at the hand of Jezebel. Here he is, just seen this amazing thing happen with God, and he's quivering at the hand of Jezebel, a woman. A woman stands before him, and he is frightened. But she wants to kill him. Maybe it's a reminder of us to keep trusting, to be brave, and be aware of our own weaknesses. But even in our weaknesses, we can trust God. And Elijah does a runner. He runs away. When Elijah is hiding, do you know what the God of love does? Do you know what he does? He meets him. He meets him in the hiding. He meets him in his weakness. He meets him when he's struggling. God feeds him. He gives him rest. He speaks to him, and then he sends him back the same way, but he sends him back differently, empowered, with a different perspective. Sometimes we need to step back and go, Lord, I'm weak. Help me, be with me, and trust God. And then we will see things from a different perspective. Let's trust our God with our weaknesses, with the things we find hard. You see, Elijah puts God first in the hard times as well as the good times. We need to love God when it's hard as well as when it's good. Choose to love him. He puts him in the center of his weakness and allows God to minister to him. If you're going through a hard time now, allow God to minister to you in your weakness and your sadness and your difficulty. That's where Jesus is, in the middle of our pain, not separate. So what can we learn about having no other gods? Loving God first from Elijah. Well, who do you love? Who do you love? And are you putting God first in your life? And what does that mean for you? See, to love God is to trust him with all of our failings and our strengths. And I don't know about you, if you love someone, you always want the best for them. The people I love, I always want the best for them. I celebrate when they do well because I love them. And Jesus wants the best for you and me. And so often we seem to think God has got a big stick ready to hammer us, but actually he wants the best for us. Be teachable. Listen to the word of God. Spend time in his presence because he wants the best for you. He wants the best life for you. And he's fun. He's fun to be with. And he's powerful and he's mighty. In Mark 12:30, it says, I love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul, with all your mind and with all your strength. That is the most important thing we can do. Because at the back of that is loving your neighbors yourself. Point is, though, when we love God first, all the rest just falls into place. That scripture was actually said to some church leaders when they asked Jesus what was the most important commandment. This is God putting love at the heart of law. I'll say that again. This is God putting love at the heart of law. This is grace fulfilling law. This is grace fulfilling law. Don't be a Pharisee. Our theology may not change, but our application does when we love. And we love people into the kingdom then. This is grace fulfilling law. And this is the foundational commandment. If you love God, then love will live in you by the Holy Spirit. And the other commandments and the other things will make sense, as all of them are actually about not hurting other people. And when we love God first, the rest falls into place. If you love God, you will love each other. I'm always suspicious when someone doesn't love the people of God. Because how can you have that? If you've got the heart of God, you will love the people of God. You will care about them. You will forgive them. You will be gracious. I don't mean putting up with things we shouldn't put up with. But so often in the church, it seems to me that we fall out with each other and we shouldn't. Over silly things. Sometimes we need to address things, I'm not saying, but we need to actually love each other. We need to show grace to each other. And if we ask God, he will also, you know, remove our idols. And I know somebody's going to talk about idols next week, I say. But actually remove our idols by the power of his spirit. And that is our choice as well, to allow God into our lives to change us, to mold us from the inside out. Our God, you see, is not a dictator. He loves us into the kingdom. What are your idols? What needs changing in your life? What needs changing in my life? It's not just to you, it's to me I speak. The commandments were given to Moses after the children of Israel, you see, had crossed the Red Sea, and God set them free from being captive in Egypt. That's when the commandments were given. They'd just come from living in a pagan society in Egypt, and now God is making it clear they have to make a choice. Who are you going to love? They're to love and trust the only living God who had set them free, because only the living God can set us free, actually. That's the same living God, like, say, we worship today. And I wonder, what is your Baal today? Money, status, power, sex, celebrity, the occult? Do you know we can't serve two things? You've got to allow God into your weakness, and he'll help you with it. Let the Spirit in. There is only one true God. He has more powerful than any dead idol. Any dead idol that holds us. In Isaiah 42:8, it says, I am the Lord. That is my name. I will not give glory to another or my praise to idols. So do you know that God loves you even when you don't love him back? That's his promise. He loves his people. He is love. He made you and created you. Ask the Holy Spirit to help you love and worship God in truth. We don't do this alone. God knows our hearts are deceitful, and he helps us with it. And like Elijah worshipped his God even when it was hard. Worship God even when it's hard. Elijah had a choice to trust God or not. He knows his God is powerful. He has a relationship with God. And even when he has moments of fear, he loves and trusts Yahweh. And we see our love. We see the love of God everywhere, by the way. If you're looking in nature, do we not see the love of God? You know, I see in my rabbits, the love of God. He created them. You're seeing your dogs, your cats, the animals. Animals have become really important during this time for those, I know particularly those that are on their own, but also just generally. But we see the love of God in nature around us, the trees, everything that God created. And can I say, we see the love of God in the mirror. Look at yourself. God loves you. He loves you. Look in the mirror and say, God loves me. That is the truth. God loves me. You are wonderfully and fearfully made. And in others, God loves them too. Even if there's someone that you find difficult, he loves them. See God in others and love them. God's love is a love that helps us to love and receive. His love is not selfish. He is love. 1 John 4:16 reads, and so we know and rely on the love of God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God lives in him. How much do you love? And I ask myself that. How much do I love? We are able to love God above all things simply because of his great love for us. He loves us first. So ask the Holy Spirit to help you to love God more. See, God, because of Jesus, understands our sin, our thoughts, our failures, but he still dies for us. Because he loves us that much. He still offers us resurrection and life forever and a new start and a new day. It is in God that we find our true self. It is in him that we experience grace and real hope. Choose to worship with your life. You know, this year I keep saying the word's going to be worship. Worship with your life. Choose to trust and choose to love. It's a choice. It's a choice, and you can pray and ask the Holy Spirit to help you. We're empowered by the Spirit to do it. Elijah trusted God, and he expected miracles from God. How expectant are you that God will do a miracle in your life? How expectant are you that tomorrow God will change something in this nation as we pray? See, when God gave the Ten Commandments, even before Moses came down Mount Sinai, the people worshipped a golden calf as an idol. They'd stopped loving their God that quickly. Just because Moses had taken a little bit of time, they went their own way. They turned from the God that loves them. How patient are you? How patient am I? Trusting God's timing. You know, we moan about 6 months, but in a lifetime, all we've been asked to do is wait on God. We're waiting on God now. We're forced to wait on God. And it's hard, and don't get me wrong, I find it hard. How patient are you, trusting God's timing for whatever it is that you need in your life, whatever you're praying for? Sometimes the preparation is just as important as the result. Because if we don't keep our eyes on Jesus, we can end up putting all our energy and trust into something that is false. How many times have you been obsessed with something? I've got to have that, I've got to have that, or I want this, and found that the reality is nothing compared to the fantasy of it. I say Rosemary will talk more on idols next week. But when we trust the path and walk in obedience with Jesus first in our lives, he will lead us to victory. He will fulfill our desires, and he will give us life and hope eternal. Proverbs 3:5-6 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your paths straight." Amen, amen, amen. Let's trust, and he will make our path straight, not in my own understanding. The prophet Micah writes, "Who is a God like you, who pardons sin and forgives the transgressions of the remnant of this inheritance? You do not stay angry forever, and you delight to show mercy." Our God wants to show mercy. He wants us to turn to him, his children, to turn to him. Love God because he loves you first, because he offers you freedom. And when we allow him to disciple us, and it's God that disciples us, I want to encourage you to read your scripture, to be teachable, to listen, to hear. Go back and look at this stuff yourself. Make your own mind up what God is saying to you. Because he offers us grace and mercy. Because God will empower you with his spirit. He will embrace you in the Father's arms. And he will give his heart for you on the cross and lead you to resurrection. He is the only way to true freedom. He is the one who will change this nation and this world. Let us have no other idols before our Jesus Christ, our God. Let's trust and love him as he loves us. Let your foundation be that his name is written on your heart. Let your foundation be that his name, Jesus Christ, is written on your heart. The question I'm going to leave you with at the end and now is, will you ask the Holy Spirit to help you love Jesus more and trust him? Even if you already do, you can ask the Holy Spirit for more. That's the great thing about our God. It's never ending. Ask him to help you love him more. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, fill us with the power of your Holy Spirit, Lord Jesus, that we may give over anything, Lord, that is an idol to you now. Challenge us in that in this next few weeks. And Lord, may we love you first because you loved us. And I pray that everyone now, Lord, that is listening to this will have a revelation of your love. They will know they are lovable. They will see themselves as lovable. They will accept the love of God in their lives. Because your love changes things, God. Lord, I pray that each one of us, when we look in the mirror, will know we are loved by God just as he made us. Give us hearts to learn to love others. Hearts that want to love others. Hearts that choose to love others as well. Lord, change us. That we may, with the power of the Holy Spirit in us, change this world. Amen. going to hand over to Christine now, who's going to lead us into our intercessions. Thank you, Christine.
Let's pray. Almighty and loving God, draw us close to you this morning. Fill us with your peace and open our eyes to see you more clearly. Open our ears to hear your voice and open our hearts to worship you more and more, so that we may grow in grace and love in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Matthew 22, verse 37 to 39. Jesus said, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is this: love your neighbor as yourself." Heavenly Father, as we continue to struggle with feelings of isolation, of being distant from families and friends, of being separated from our neighbors and our church family, and of having our lives completely turned upside down, we give thanks and praise that there is nothing in all of creation, not even coronavirus, that can separate us from your love. We continue to pray for all those who have become unwell due to this virus, as the numbers are still rising both locally and nationally, whether they are in isolation at home or in the care of nursing staff in hospital. In their weakness, give them strength. Surround them with the light of your love and healing. We pray too for our NHS, and particularly today, we think of our local hospitals, for Barnet, for North Middlesex, for the Royal Free, who are now really struggling under the extreme pressure of daily numbers of cases needing to be admitted. Lord, we read stories of hospital staff feeling overwhelmed and having to make some incredibly difficult and upsetting decisions. We give thanks for their dedication and professionalism. Give them all that they need to be able to carry out their jobs, and at the end of their shifts, fill them with your peace. Give them rest and keep them safe. May your love that never fails continue to be shared through the kindness of strangers, looking out for each other, for neighbours, near and far, all recognising our shared vulnerability. Each of us grateful for every breath and willing everyone to know the gift of a full and healthy life in accordance with your will. Almighty God, we pray for our day of prayer and fasting tomorrow. Lord, you are a mighty and all-powerful God who loves to draw his people closer to him. Father, we ask for your blessing upon our time in prayer and fasting tomorrow as we seek your grace and mercy, as we look to you for a breakthrough with this pandemic. Help us to pursue healing and to be freed from all anxiety, while we wait upon you for a miracle. Show us how to rest and find your peace when all around us is uncertain, chaotic, and frightening. Fill us afresh with the wonder of your love and power, and keep our eyes firmly fixed on you. Help us to actively live out our faith as we wait for you to break through in our lives and our world. May our lives display your power and majesty. Do the impossible, Lord, we pray, and bring us by your might safely through this pandemic, that we may all be united together in one hope, one faith, and one Lord. Ephesians 4, verses 4 to 6. There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. during this pandemic, it has struck me as being quite unusual that the symbol of Thanksgiving has been the rainbow, an opportunity for us to clap for carers and more recently to applaud our heroes, something which has brought our communities together and helped us to reconnect with one another once a week. This is something that as a Christian I have always associated with God's affirmity to us that all will be well and that he is in charge. In Christian culture, a rainbow promises better times to come. God sent one to Noah after the great flood as a sign that people could go forth and multiply without fear of another calamitous drowning. So for non-Christians to adopt this as a symbol of thanksgiving and hope during this pandemic has felt quite strange to me, but also incredibly encouraging. I believe that God is saying to us as Christians, use this symbol, the rainbow, as an opportunity to communicate with others the hope that is in Christ Jesus and bear witness to all what he has done for us and what he will do for all those who turn back to him and accept him as their Lord and Saviour. Merciful Father, help us to love as you love us. We pray for all those who are grieving the loss of loved ones, both to the virus and for other reasons. For our young people struggling with disrupted education and the prospect of finding it hard to get employment once they have finished their studies. For all those who have been furloughed and have no idea when they might return to work, and the concerns this brings about their financial situation. For those who live alone and feel isolated and cut off from family and friends. And for all those frightened and concerned about catching the virus and the toll this is taking on their mental health. And this morning we particularly pray for Jamie Hope, who in the last 2 days has been diagnosed with COVID. Father, we just pray you protect the Hope family, for Jamie, for Vicky, for Sarah and for Chris. Be with them, help them to know that you walk with them and keep them safe. And Almighty God, help us to all to remember your promises to us and keep us strong in faith and steadfastness, looking to you for all things. Isaiah 40:31, but those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Isaiah 43:2, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. And Deuteronomy 31:8, the Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Fill us with your Holy Spirit, for we are weak, Lord. But we know also that even when we are weak, you are strong within us. Thank you that it's not all up to us. Thank you that you equip us to face each day with the power of your love, your forgiveness and your grace. We love you, Lord, and we need you today and every day. In Jesus' name, amen. And now let's turn back to God with the words that our Saviour has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Christine, for those wonderful prayers. And we've got Peter now, I think. Come.
Good morning, everyone. And we are now on our journey of 2021. And what a wonderful year this will be. I know to help us along this journey, we have our prayer day on the 11th of January, which Rev Laura shared with her fellow clergy. And so hopefully this will turn out to be our national day of prayer. Praise the Lord. But the 11th of January is also a very special day, and I'm trying to remember why it's so special. Now, to help me remember, I have asked two of my friends to come, form a choir and sing our favourite song. I hope this jogs my memory. So, Zoomers, the words will be on the screen, so sing along. And I hope it will remind me why it's so special today. So let's go over to the Vicarage stage. Come with me, everybody. Hello, Roof. Hello, Blue. Are you ready to sing?
Yeah.
Can you give me an A?
A?
Give me an A, Bob. A?
No, A? No, no. A? We need the A? Note A.
Oh.
Perfect. I think we're ready to sing our favourite song.
Yeah.
1, 2, 3, 4. Happy birthday to thee. May God bless you, we pray. Live for Jesus, dear Simon. Happy birthday to you.
Now,
I'll give you all a clue if you're not sure which Simon it is.
Oh.
It's the wonderful church warden.
Carol. Oh, no, you said Simon. No.
Hey!
Simon. Oh, I know. Simon, he loves you, Simon.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.
I know that Simon would have loved that. You can get Paul back later, okay? Bless you. Happy birthday, Simon. You are amazing, church warden, and you are an amazing person, and you're an amazing man of God. So have a wonderful birthday, and thank you for all that you do. From me and everybody who I know appreciates you. We're going to notices now. I'm going to start with the prayer notices, the prayer project. Jenny's prayer project, well, it's not Jenny, it's God's, but Jenny's enabling it. We are praying and prayer walking up Crescent Road today. So if you could be praying for Crescent Road, and if you want to prayer walk it, go and prayer walk it. Be fantastic. We've always said loads about the 11th and the day of prayer, so just engage. That's all I'll say to you is please engage, get with it. That'd be fantastic. A reminder that we are on morning prayer live. Well, on a Monday, we'll be doing it three times, obviously, this week. But we're also on a Wednesday, 8:30 to 8:45, we'll be doing morning prayer there as well. At the moment, the church is not open during the week because we want to be safe. And on Sunday, like I say, it will be Zoom for those that can't Zoom or struggle with Zoom or are part of the service, but nobody else. If you can Zoom, that would be great. And we want to be as safe as we can. And if there's any more notices or anything from the government or from the church, I will let you know if it changes and if things change. And that will be probably for the next 3 weeks as we are. But after that, hopefully, once we've had our prayer day, we'll be opening up again. Wouldn't that be great? Wouldn't that be amazing to see that? So, yes, prayer and fasting. Facebook Live sessions, 8:30 a.m., 1 p.m., and Zoom, also 8:30 p.m. Check out those dates, but 8:30 p.m. when you can actually join in on the Zoom as well. So that's been given to you, so please do join in on the Zoom as well. It'd be fantastic. And a reminder as well to sign up for Facebook and YouTube, because they'll be on there as well. So sign up for Facebook and YouTube. We're also doing our Bible study, which is a four-week Bible study. Bible course, four-week Bible study, starting on the 14th of January, every Thursday for 4 weeks, 8 p.m. on Zoom. There's the meeting ID, 860-9344-2305. I will send it out, so don't worry. So you don't have to quickly write that down, but I will send it out. But there it is if you want it. You want to take a photo of it quickly now, so you've got it. Would you let me know if you're coming? It helps me to make sure I put you in the right groups. You will be put under your life group leaders if you're in a life group. If you're not, don't worry about it. You will be put in a group with someone who will be leading you, so do not worry. We're doing choice this week. We're talking about choice, so do join us. Great to have you. Got a load of people already signed up for that, which is great. I think that's all I've got, isn't it? Yes. We've got Martine. Shall we have Martine? We haven't had Martine for a couple of weeks. Hey? Screen's gone. Oh. Miss Whittaker. Okay. Well, if we can't find her, we can always put Martine, if you could put up in the thing what we need for food bank, if we can't find you. Okay, I'll give you a minute. We could do text giving. Have we got the text giving slide? Probably not. Am I just confusing you now? Anyway, text giving, if you want to give by text, there we go. It is 70450. It's a great way to give. 70450, the text number. You put St. James, space, how much you want to give. So it's 1 to 20 you can put in that. It's been a great way to help people give during this time. And we just thank God for everyone that gives. We thank God for our finances, for our finance team. We ask for a blessing on it. Lord, help us to be good stewards and continue to be good stewards. There's other ways to give, of course, as well. But Lord, thank you for all that you are doing in us now. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So any Martine or not? No, okay. Martine, if you could put it in the chat, that would be brilliant. We come to the end of our service now, and I'm just going to end with a final blessing. May the Lord Jesus, the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit be with you all, remain with you always, and all those that you love at this time. And Lord, help us to love you more. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with every single one of us now and always. Amen. Amen. So those of you that are on Zoom are going to go into your breakout groups. And a reminder of the question, ask the Holy Spirit to help you to love Jesus and trust him more. Ask the Holy Spirit to help you love and trust Jesus more. So God bless you all, and I will see you soon. And let's get praying, church, tomorrow. Let's really pray for an end of COVID. Amen.